Megha. She is from India and has put together an HD documentary, which she is going to share with us. So really looking forward to hearing from you, Megha, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
And also, just before you start, I'd just like to let everyone know that we've got exhibitions, or we've got booths available. So head on over to the exhibition area when you get a chance and jump into one of those booths, see who you can meet and what else you can find out. Otherwise, thank you for being with us. And Megha, I'll pass over to you.
Okay. So I thought I'll quickly introduce myself and then maybe I can show you all the trailer and then we can go backwards and I can tell you how that came about. So I'm Megha. I live in Delhi, India, and I'm 28. I'm also a filmmaker. So professionally, I'm a filmmaker and a writer. And one of the things that I've always enjoyed doing since I was in college is trying to document as much as my family's history, because it's something that I find pretty fascinating. And that's where making this film began. So let me start by showing y'all the trailer and then we can go from there.
So you started seeing the change in it immediately after you got married?
Almost immediately. I wouldn't call it a change. I saw temper tantrums. I saw...
Why did you not tell us? This is literally the only question I have to ask. Why didn't you tell us?
What was there to say? What is the use of telling you after both of you are born that you may be carrying a genetic disease?
Because it helps planning the future.
I'd ask you if you worried whether any of us would have it. And you said you worried that I might have the disease.
Because in you I saw a certain emotional volatility. Because I'd seen that with Papa.
I have a feeling if you had told me these things in my teens, I would have made reason for why Papa used to behave that way, which obviously I didn't.
Possibly she was the Huntington's gene. We were able to trace back to the family.
Huntington's disease, a devastating neurodegenerative condition with no cure,
leads the patient to develop problems with their mood, their movement, and their thinking. And these symptoms are progressive.
My grandfather he's 450 in this? 65 something? I don't know, how old was he? He was 70 when he died.
I just didn't want to tell you for the longest time that I wanted to get tested.
What would I achieve? Or what would you achieve? What will you change? The inevitable is the inevitable.
I would never get tested. It's like not just for Huntington's. If somebody told you the day you were going to die, right? It's the same thing. Why would I want to know it?
Even I didn't know what Papa had. If I knew what he had, I would never have conceived.
It doesn't help knowing that there is a problem happening, because you should live your life independent of whether that problem is going to happen or not.
I have gone through enough years not sharing. Maybe that's a mistake.
Give life a shot, with or without this test, you know. Because I don't think you are defined by this.
So society will have to decide, is this a part of a normal genetic heritage? How far can you edit and remove all disease? You may not be left with a human being at all.
Hi.
I got my results.
Okay. So I will quickly run into my slides and then I can talk a little more about this. Okay. Let me get to where it all started. I think one thing to keep in mind, at least for me, was that my father and I were very, very similar as people in many aspects. We obviously had a lot of similar interests. We both loved mountaineering. We loved history. We loved books. We shared the same birthday. We were the same, like we were roosters according to the Chinese calendar. We had like beauty spots in the same parts of our bodies. So we were very, very similar as people. And I think I shared a great bond with him for a lot of my childhood. But then once I was a teen, I started seeing differences in him as a person. It was very slow. I think it was first, obviously, the mental changes. He was depressive. He would overthink. He wouldn't talk to people. He stopped socializing with people. And it was absolutely not the kind of person that he was. And I was very young and I didn't completely understand what was going on. Even more so because nobody in my family kind of ever brought up the words Huntington's. I was the younger sibling. Nobody really discussed anything with me. So I had no idea what was happening at home at that point. And then I started seeing the physical changes in him. His shoulders started drooping. He had jittery movements. His gait was very difficult. And he'd have difficulty eating, talking. He would slur. It came to a point where by the time I was 15, 16, I was completely embarrassed of him. I didn't want to be around him. At that point, I honestly thought that he was doing all of this to kind of chase my friends away so I wouldn't bring them home. I wouldn't ever talk about my dad. And I was very, very quiet about this because this was a big part of my life. I was coming home to a sick parent. I didn't know what he was sick with. And nobody ever told me what was happening. So I kind of shut off this part of myself. And I think I carried that on for a couple of years. Now, when I did go into college, I started, I regained a bond with him because we were living in two different cities at that point. So on a weekly basis, I'd talk to him and he'd tell me how his day had been. I'd tell him how my day had been. And the bond started slowly building back up. And at that point, he would say, you know, I'm sick. You know, I can't do this because I'm sick. But again, the words Huntington's never really featured in any of these conversations. And I was still confused, but I wanted to build everything that I had with him back. But I was living away. Every 3 or 4 months that I did come home, I'd see a very sharp decline. And I knew we were kind of reaching the end of it. And then my father passed away in 2016, in January. I wasn't, at that point, I did know it was Huntington's, but it was a very strange time for my family because my brother was getting married 5 days later. And as a family, we kind of shut off what had happened and his death and kind of went ahead with the wedding, which I think helped us kind of subdue what had happened and the shock of it and just kind of celebrate the union of two people and something that my father would have liked being a part of. So that year in August, it would be my father's 58th birthday and it was my 23rd birthday. And I decided to come back to Calcutta and I decided on a whim to take my camera out, sit down with my mother, sit down with my grandmother, and just talk to them about memories with my dad. I felt like if we spoke about him, if we spoke about what he had been through, the kind of person that he used to be, it would help us therapeutically come to terms with what exactly had happened and remember him in the best light possible. Because the last few years before he passed away was very, very difficult and very challenging for my family. And they finally started speaking up about Huntington's disease and what it was. And that's when I first started understanding everything about it. So now if I go into the journey of my family very briefly, what I did realize at that point was that we definitely do know that my grandfather had Huntington's. This is my grandfather when he was maybe in his 30s. And then we have my grandfather on the right in his late 60s. This would probably have been maybe a couple of months or a year before he had passed away. I never saw my grandfather. He died 4 days before my birth. But I did know that he was sick And again, I had been told different stories. Somebody had said he had Parkinson's. Somebody said he had a stroke. Somebody said he just had a heart attack. Somebody said he had dementia. So I just knew he was sick, but I kind of never put everything together and tried understanding what had happened. And then over the years, slowly after his passing, my aunt started showing symptoms, and we didn't live in the same city as her. She would visit us and we'd visit her every summer. And then when we did move to the city that she did live in, we'd visit her every Thursday. And that's, I was really young. I was 7, 8 at that point. And watching her was extremely scary. I didn't know what was happening. She was bone thin. She wouldn't speak. She wouldn't remember anything. She was on a Ryle's tube. She was bedridden. She had a lot of jerky movements. She was really not there mentally for many, many years before she passed away. And it scared me because I was very young. And I saw the effect it had on my grandmother and my father, because they were very close to her, and they didn't take it very well. I remember this one time when I was maybe 9 or 10, and I was crossing my parents' room, and my dad was sitting up in bed, and it was maybe like 2 o'clock at night, and he was crying and he was worked up, and he was telling my mother that, I'm scared I'm gonna get what she has. And I never kind of made sense of that. It does make sense now. But then I did know that my family was very, very worked up by how sick she was. And she passed away in 2008. And then slowly my father started showing symptoms shortly after that. And he'd already had a lot of behavioral issues before that, but the physical symptoms started around 2008, 2009. So when I did start making the film and understanding the whole history of my family, I realized, it kind of drove me towards wanting to know for myself whether I had it too, because I am unfortunately or fortunately the kind of person who cannot live with uncertainty. It's just, it gives me more anxiety than knowing what I have and maybe planning towards that. And I started getting in touch with organizations online, because there wasn't much help in India at that point. I was probably 19 and I was like really young. The first place I got in touch with was HDYO's Facebook page and a couple of organizations in the US, just to understand how like the genetic testing takes place, what happens before and after. And I was a little quiet about wanting to get tested because my father was still alive at that point, and my mother was very scared that if I did go ahead and get tested and it was positive, my father would not be able to deal with that news. So we kind of kept it off for a couple of years. But then after he passed away, I told my mother that I'm simply going ahead with it. And she agreed to it. And I had pretty odd genetic testing, I would say. To put it very briefly, I went into the geneticist's office. I was given a history of what exactly Huntington's is, how it comes down, what my family's history might have been, since nobody had actually been clinically tested before me. And I was taken for a blood test maybe half an hour later, and I was given my results in 3 days. So I had no time to actually process any of it. And this is just how genetic testing worked in India up to 5, 6 years back. I would like to believe I took it pretty well, because I had convinced myself up to that point that it is going to be positive, because I just wanted to be prepared for the worst. But that test kind of drove me further towards wanting to make the film. It gave me a level of motivation, not just for myself, because I felt like I belonged even more to a community that nobody was speaking about in India. I felt cheated by the medical system and how the process was. And I obviously wanted to do this in my dad's memory, because now that I could see that there was a very high likelihood of me someday becoming like my father, it made me realize that in the years that I had ignored him, where I didn't want to acknowledge him, where I was embarrassed by him, I had taken no time in trying to understand who he was as a person. And I wanted to be able to make a film to be able to pay back for everything he had done as a parent for us, because he was an incredible parent. He was ill, but he was a wonderful parent nonetheless. So that is what motivated me to start making the film. When I did start making the film, one of the things that at that point, the Huntington Society in India was just coming about. And I had the luck of being in touch with a couple of doctors who did get me in touch with 4 or 5 families in India who were willing to speak about Huntington's and their experiences with it too. This was the first time I was ever interacting with an Indian family that had Huntington's. Maybe till I was 16, 17, I didn't even know families had Huntington's. And now I was coming across families. There was a WhatsApp group created where a lot of other families were joining in. So it felt like a breakthrough in what was happening in the Indian landscape of people coming up and talking about the disease, wanting to interact, wanting to create support groups, wanting to create an association. And I felt like that was the right time for me to go in and make this film and try and make it about all the other families, including my own, so that I can give a vast understanding of the Indian landscape and the Indian society and how Huntington's is perceived, not just in India, but also possibly in the Indian subcontinent. So when I did start that, that's when Piano Fingers came about. When we, to begin with, we started with 5 families and my own family. And it was slightly turbulent because we do have some, obviously we have a lack of medical healthcare and knowledge and awareness in India, but we also have discrepancies in terms of how healthcare and is perceived. So a lot of people were nervous about coming up on screen or wanting to speak or being heard or being recognized on camera, which was a bit of a challenge when we did start. But it taught me a lot about people from different socioeconomic backgrounds and the perception that they had of Huntington's or what they felt Huntington's was for them, which I will get to later. So this is what my film is about. When Megha loses her father to Huntington's disease, a rare and curable genetic disorder, she arms herself with a camera to understand what took him. As Megha and her family reflect on the slow but irrevocable changes that the disease brought to her father, she must also confront the fact that she might have inherited the genetic mutation herself. The film chronicles the ambition and struggles of a young filmmaker who battles with the profound ethical dilemma of getting tested and the implication that the outcome would have on everything from the family to her worldview. Piano Fingers paints an intimate portrait of a family that must learn to redefine hope, acceptance, fragility, and their purpose in life in the face of this insurmountable disease. When we did kind of move in the direction of trying to make the film a little more about my family, because we didn't want to kind of disrespect the other family's hesitance in being on screen, we kind of focused on me and my brother and my mother and how we had dealt with Huntington's, how I was dealing with testing positive, what my brother's views were about not wanting to get tested, and my mother's experience as a primary caregiver to my father and to my grandfather when he was there. So I'd like to show you all 2 snippets from my mom and my brother, and then I can move on to the next bit.
Day he passed away from your point of view.
So I had come back home to get married. So I had come back home at 4 in the morning or something, 4, 5 in the morning. And I was woken up at around 7, and my mom said, Papa is having some breathing problem. You know, he collapsed and then passed away. And I was actually it saved many years of, problems that he would have faced.
So the first thing that came to your mind would have been relief?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously he was a shadow of himself, no doubt, but there was many things that were still very much in common with how he was earlier.
Was it painful to watch him become like that?
Yeah, but beyond the point, it doesn't help feeling bad. Can't change that. What you can do is accept and do your best from your end. I would never get tested. My opinion on that is very simple, that it doesn't help knowing that there is a problem happening, because you should live your life independent of whether that problem is going to happen or not. It's like not just for Huntington's. If somebody told you the day you were going to die, right? It's the same thing. Why would I want to know it?
And I'm just quickly taking through one more.
What do you think pulled Papa down the most about the fact that he had Huntington's?
The fact that his mind stopped working.
He couldn't deal with that.
He couldn't deal with it. When he was rational, you see, it's horrible, because the phobias, the OCDs were not in his control. So he's telling himself it's a phobia, it's an OCD, but he can't control the behavior. That is not in his control. That bothered him. That really troubled him. You know, how do you deal with it? And you know that there is no treatment. You know there is no cure. So what do you do? You just take every single day as it comes. That's the way I dealt with it.
This, I remember this book, the Hillary Clinton book. Till his dying day, he kept reminding me once a week. Have you read that book? You have to read that book. Have you read it? So I will read it. Knowing full well, I'll never read it, but he would tell me once a week. So this was one of his big favorites. I mean, I don't even know how old it is. 1971 was big favorite. He had his books, some like his cricket books or something else his cricket books.
So that was two snippets from my brother and my mother. They obviously have two varying perspectives. My brother especially has the polar opposite perspective to Huntington's than me. I would say that when we did start making the film, he was probably the most difficult person for me to talk to, because even as siblings, we kind of never ever spoke about Huntington's. And now I was putting him in front of a camera, and I had a crew around me, and I was asking him extremely personal questions that we had never discussed even in a private room. And it was very difficult for him to talk about everything that had happened. Though one of the things that we did realize when we were speaking about it is that he did have much happier memories of my father, unlike me, because he is older than me. So he had seen better years, 3-4 better years than me. And he was of a rational mind. He did understand what was going on with my father. He did know we had Huntington's in the house. So it was easier for him to come to terms with it. And while he doesn't like speaking about Huntington's at all, it's very difficult for him. He kind of shuts it out, doesn't discuss it with anyone. This was the first time we'd kind of broken a wall, which again for the family was incredible, because we had gone decades without speaking about Huntington's. And then this film was allowing us to finally open up, talk about everything, and just understand what had happened and kind of prepare for the future in terms of what could happen to either my brother or me in the coming years. So once we did start making the film, like I said, we went and interviewed 5 families, and the journey of making the film was really eye-opening. We spoke to families who lived in urban cities, but we also spoke to families that were in rural areas, and they were polar opposites in terms of how they perceived Huntington's. For example, the family that we're interviewing in this picture over here live in a very small rural city in South India. And when their father had Huntington's, Huntington's, because nobody else around them knew what Huntington's was, because it looked odd, because everyone assumed he was drunk, because his behavior was weird. People kind of shunned him and his whole family. And when they did figure out that he is sick, because they've never heard the term Huntington's in their life before, it's not something that's ever taught in our medical books and biology classes. It's not taught in a lot of medical schools either. So there's such a lack of knowledge around the disease. And like Karam had mentioned yesterday, for the Middle East, where a lot of terms that you have for Huntington's and like on HD Buzz are in English. So for somebody who isn't fluent in English, it's very difficult for them to grasp the knowledge of Huntington's, or the fact that it's genetic, or the fact that it's degenerative. That's something that this family didn't know. And they truly did believe that they were cursed, and their family had done something in their past lifetime that was resulting in this. And the families around them thought that Huntington's was contagious, so they stayed away because they didn't want to catch it. So that was the lack of knowledge in this family. And it really opened my eyes to wanting to educate. Obviously, awareness was the most important thing for me. I wanted to make sure that people, that at least the words Huntington's disease could be in everyone's mind. And when I say I have Huntington's disease, you know what I'm talking about. But it was also about educating people in India about what exactly it is, educating families that have it themselves about what the repercussions are, what they need to know, what they don't need to know, what kind of healthcare they can get. So this was one of the things, one of the takings that I did take from the film while I was making it. Again, I think what the film taught me is very similar to what I just said. I think I was very young when I started making the film. I was only 22, 23. And in the last 5 years, I have grown a lot in terms of understanding families and my own family in terms of how everyone perceives Huntington's differently. When I did walk in at 22, 23, I was convinced that everybody should get tested and everybody has the right to know. And anybody who does come from a Huntington's family should absolutely speak about it and should be open about it, and they shouldn't cower away, they shouldn't hide. And the film kind of taught me that that wasn't the case with every family. I really believe that I was lucky with my family, that they were accepting and that they did want it to come out in the open, and that we had we came from a more privileged background to be able to speak about this without a financial repercussion or a societal repercussion, which wasn't the case with every other family. And I think every single person that comes from a Huntington's family, whether you've tested negative, whether you've not tested, whether you've tested positive, if your parent had it, if your child has it, everybody has their own journey in accepting the disease and dealing with the disease. And I think that's what the film has primarily taught me, that, I mean, we all have very similar stories in terms of what our parents might have gone through, or what we might go through, but how we deal with it is very, very different for each person. And I think it just taught me to respect everybody's point of view and respect everybody's privacy more than anything else, and, you know, not just come out in the open and be there for everyone to talk about. Why do I feel like such a film is important? So what we did do with we've been shooting for a couple of years. The film is still in production, but we did go for Good Pitch India 2020, where 6 Indian documentaries were selected for monetary and other help in terms of creating the documentary. What I realized when I was making the film is that a lot of documentary filmmakers or filmmakers kind of make a film and they just, once the film is released and everyone's seen it, you wrap up and you move on to your next film, which is something I definitely didn't want to do with this film. I wanted the film to be a tool to create a certain level of impact in the Indian landscape. So we decided that we would do a lot of work with the film in terms of whether we could screen in hospitals across India, whether we could screen in medical schools across India, if we could have it in different Indian languages, so it's obviously easily understandable. The film would also be used to create self-help guidebooks, whether for somebody who is a caregiver, for somebody who is in the process of getting tested, whether you've tested negative or positive, or for somebody who is pre-symptomatic or is already, you know, showing symptoms of Huntington's, because we don't have that over here. It also allowed me to kind of work very closely with the Huntington's Disease Society of India to kind of figure out if we want to make self-help groups and, you know, what every other kind of thing that we can do where the film is just a visual medium for somebody to watch, but then we obviously have something after that for someone to take away from the film. So that's what we're working on right now. And where is the film currently? Well, the film is still in production. We've been shooting for a couple of years, but unfortunately documentaries can take up to 10 years to make. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed that in another two years that the film will get made. We've kind of moved in the direction of kind of exploring only my family and how we have dealt with the disease, and obviously talking to experts in India about the changing landscape for medical healthcare. And so I think 2023, we should see the film get completed. And yeah, finally, I think I just wanted to say that the film has, it's been very important for me to make such a film. And I want everyone to be able to see films like this, because while we have had a lot of documentaries about Huntington's across the world, we don't see a Huntington's patient in mainstream media. We don't see them as a character in a series. We don't see them in a feature film. And we definitely don't see them in the Indian or the Indian subcontinental landscape, where the society is very, very different. So I want to be able to bring that about through the film, where Indians and people from our society can see themselves and feel like they're accepted. And maybe that pushes them to kind of understand what they have and open up about it. So that was me.
Awesome. Megha, thank you so much. What a cool presentation. So awesome to hear about your family history and with Huntington's, your own personal journey, and this incredible work that you're doing with this documentary. There's a few of us that are already waiting for the documentary to come out, so we will certainly be keeping our eyes on that, and no doubt that will be shared through the HDYO contact. So all the best, and thank you so much for being with us today, and no doubt we'll all be out there promoting your documentary for you as well when it does come out.
Thank you. Thanks.
Cool. And then just to everybody that has joined us, next up, we've got Dr. Kelly Aikens from Monash University, and she's talking about a stress study that they're currently working on. So what you'll need to do is just leave this session, head back to the auditorium, and you'll be able to join the session from there. And we'll see you over in the next one. Awesome. Thank you.